We tend to find so much to disagree on these days, but can we agree that as Christians, when we find something written in the Bible, we're supposed to do what it says? Obviously, I think those of us who are here today, for the most part, would agree with that in principle. I think we're better at obedience in certain areas than we are in others. The Bible says, you will not kill, thou shalt not kill. And maybe if we fudge a little bit on that thing about hating your brother, we're pretty good at that one. I doubt we have. I mean, if we have murderer, somebody that's killed here, and you've repented of your sins, you're welcome. Praise God, because all sins are under the blood of Christ, but we don't have a lot of people who have committed that sin. Again, ignoring Jesus in your heart standard from Matthew 5, we try to uphold the biblical standard for marriage and give due regard to the command, you shall not commit adultery. Churches will still fire their pastors for that and even discipline members who are caught violating that one. We don't rob banks, do we? Don't sell drugs. Anyone? Don't want to wake up. Somebody wakes up and raises their hand because no, we don't do that. Any members of organized crime here? You know, any Sopranos? Not the choir kind of Sopranos. You know the kind I'm talking about. Even in this permissive era, you know, those big sins. But there are other commands, equally, even perhaps more clear in Scripture, that are heavily emphasized, clear, unequivocal scriptural commands that we ignore almost at will in the Bible. Philippians 4:4 says, rejoice in the Lord always. And because Paul was a good Baptist, he repeated himself. I will say it again, rejoice. We are to rejoice always, and in all things we're to live lives of constant joy, regardless of our circumstances. Is there a way Paul could have made that more clear? Do I need to clarify that command? From sunup to sundown, Monday through Sunday, or Sunday through Saturday. However, as a preacher, I always sort of regard my week as Monday through Sunday. Sunday's kind of the culmination of my week, but anyway, we are to live lives of constant rejoicing at every moment. Now, does that describe your life? Constant rejoicing, morning, noon, and night, 7 days a week, 52 weeks a year. Let's be honest. We do not obey that command with as much vigor as we enforce others. That passage in Philippians 4 goes on to get downright annoying because it adds, don't worry about anything. Instead, we're to pray and live in a perfect peace that passes understanding, that guards our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. In times of fear and stress and tension, our hearts are to be at perfect rest and perfect peace. Fear, stress, and worry ought to have no place in the life of a Christian. They ought not to govern our lives. Again, is there anything unclear in that passage? Don't worry. Do you know what worry is? About anything. Do you know what the word anything means? Don't worry about anything. Could Paul have made that clearer? Instead, pray, give it all to God, and a perfect peace that passes understanding will guard your hearts and minds. The only question is whether we obey the command of God. And most of us, frankly, live worried lives, stressed and fearful. I'll be honest, I don't want to go too many details, but you guys know we've lived 40 years working for the same company, four different branch offices, and our lives have been pretty settled. And there's a lot of times when things are, you know, no church is settled all the time. There's been conflicts, there's been up and downs, but now we're in a place where we're not sure what the next year or two is going to be for us. And we haven't been in a place like this for 40 years, where we don't know where we're going to be this time next year. And, you know, we prayed. I've been asking God for a long time to show His will, and He did that. And I'm not questioning that. I think we know where God wants this church to go, but that leaves us with a lot of unanswered questions, and it's left me kind of staring at the ceiling at night. Well, not really staring at the ceiling, because I have that CPAP machine on, and you know, staring at the ceiling doesn't work that well. Staring at the inside of my eyeballs. Just with a whole lot of questions about us and what's going to, you know, what we're going to do. And the reason I share that is not for sympathy, because a lot of you have other issues in your lives. The reason I share that is because, frankly, I just confess sin to you. And your response was probably one of two responses, either me too, I'm doing the same thing, or don't worry about it, Dave, no big deal. I just stood in this pulpit and said that I am not obeying the scripture, don't worry about anything. And there doesn't seem to be horror on anybody's faces. It's probably because most of us are living in worry and fear about politics in this country. We're stressed and fearful about our finances and where the economy is headed, either in the large or where our personal finances are headed, where our health is headed, where our family's headed, or something else. We live lives of worry. And the thing about it is, worry, you know, it's not the way that we are supposed to live. We live in this kind of raucous life. You ever gone whitewater rafting? It's exciting. That's kind of the way we live our lives, in these exciting, you know, riding in this boat. But if you fall out, it's like, you know, it's, you know, it can be pretty dangerous. And that's kind of the way we live our lives today. Going down this white water, and it just seems like if anything goes wrong, it's all going to fall apart. But the fact of the matter is, when you know Jesus Christ, it's never okay to live in worry, stress, and fear, because God has provided something different. It's not only sinful to worry, but it's a waste. God says, I did not give you a spirit of fear, a spirit of stress and worry. I gave you a spirit, I gave you a power and love and a sound mind. I gave you my Holy Spirit so that you could have something better than fear and stress and worry. And when we're living in worry and fear and stress and panic and all those things, we are not living in the fullness that Jesus Christ died and rose again to provide for us. We continue to study the Holy Spirit and this great conflict in Galatians 5, 19 and 23, 19 through 23, between the works of the flesh and the power of the Holy Spirit, the fruit that He wants to produce in us, this fruit, these nine character qualities that reflect Christ. Let me read them again to you this week. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. The law is not against such things. Now, as we've said in previous weeks, these nine evidences of the work of the Holy Spirit in us, in the life of the believer, these nine characteristics of Christ form three different groupings of three. There's three and three and three, and that adds up to nine. And we probably all knew that, right? Three and three and three makes nine. And the first group, spiritual living, spiritual life, these are the root qualities, the root attitudes, the heart attitudes that we have. Last week we looked at love. This week we'll look at joy and peace, and we'll see. Joy and peace are what I call the spirit twins. They're so often closely related in the scripture. One tends to appear with the other. They walk together. They share a spiritual DNA. That's true of all of these to an extent, but these two share close DNA. Like last week when we talked about love, joy and peace are Christ active. I hope you're familiar with this term, but as is often the case, I'm going to re-explain it to you anyway. Christ active means that we don't live reactive to our circumstances. We don't respond to the way other people treat us or respond to the circumstances of the world. Our love is not based on how others treat us. Our joy is not based on the circumstances of the world. Our peace is not based on what's going on around us, but on what Christ has done for us. We are to be dominated by the work of God in Christ in us. We love because He first loved us. We have joy because we focus on what God is doing, has done, and will do for us. We are at peace because we trust our sovereign Lord and what He is doing. And when we're Christ active, it changes our perspective. And that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about joy and peace. Joy unspeakable, that's what 1 Peter 1:8 calls it, joy unspeakable. Whoops, I just turned that off. Joy unspeakable, and then we're going to talk about the peace that passes understanding. Joy unspeakable, which produces the full glory of God in us. Our lives are to be marked daily by an overwhelming, overflowing joy based on the work of God in us through Christ. Now, frankly, if you go around in this world with this overflowing joy despite circumstances, people will think you're nuts. I'm not kidding, folks. You will probably get health and wellness checks if you walk around with the overflowing joy of Jesus in your heart. Because people expect you to be weighed down by the circumstances of life. But we are to walk under the power of the Holy Spirit, who will produce in us a joy unspeakable based on what Jesus Christ does in us. Now, this unspeakable joy is rooted in God's love. Now, God's love was listed first because all of the qualities root in the love of God. Remember, we said that last week. All of these fruit of the Spirit root in the love of God. They all come out of that same tree, if you will. Joy comes when we remember that we are recipients of an undeserved, unearned love, and that God takes sinners like we are, sinners who are worthy of eternal death, and gives us eternal life in Christ. Now look, I can focus on my fears. I can live my life holding on to my anger about whatever I might think happened to me. I can wallow in my doubts or my problems, or I can remember what God has done for me. I can remember that God sent His Son for me, that Jesus gave His life for me, that He endured the shame of the cross for the joy of saving sinners like me, that His blood was shed so that my sins, not in part but the whole, were nailed to the cross and I bear them no more. I can remember that Jesus rose up from the dead, victorious over death and hell and this present evil age and sin and Satan and over every single thing that could possibly bother me today or in the future. I may be unworthy, but I am loved by the love of God. I don't have to know the future when my life is in the hands of a God who knows the beginning from the end. And if Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever, what do we have to fear? And our joy comes when we choose to focus on God and not on our circumstances. Joy is a choice to turn my eyes on Jesus and instead of what is happening in the world and to revel in the love of God for me. Joy is not just about happy times. Paul said some crazy things in his writings. He said some really odd things. And these things only make sense if Jesus Christ is truly our Lord and if he is alive. 2 Corinthians 6:10 is one of those crazy things. He says, we are grieving, yet always rejoicing. Huh? What? We are grieving, yet always rejoicing. Now, folks, that makes no sense unless there is a God in heaven doing amazing things. But what Paul means is that because there is a God in heaven doing supernatural things in our lives, we don't have to live under the weight of those things which weigh us down and bear us down. In Philippians 4:11, Paul speaks of being content whatever the circumstances of life. Philippians 4 is one of the more misused scriptures. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And people have it like, and I can win the championship. It has nothing to do with winning the championship. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me means if I am living high on the hog, I can depend on Christ. And if I have lost everything and my life is falling apart, I can do all things through Christ. Look at it in context. It's not about I can win the game through Christ who strengthens me. It's about I can lose the game and still walk in Christ. I can endure whatever this life throws at me in Christ and still have joy. As believers, our joy is not based on anything this world gives us. We don't pursue pleasure or comfort or ease or prosperity. None of these things is inherently sinful. They're not bad to have those things, but they're not the source of our joy. Our joy comes from the work of the Holy Spirit in us. Now there are two key words that we need to know that relate to joy. They often appear with joy, and they kind of help us understand what joy is all about and how it takes place in our lives. The first word is grace. Etymologically, that means the root of the words. These two words are actually cousins. They come from the same Greek root word, C-H-A-R, char. Actually, it's an X-A-R, but whatever. It means grace and joy, actually. It has the idea of a gift. And joy is rooted in the grace of God that has been given to us. When everything is going great, the most important truth in my... When I win the lottery, which is going to be very difficult unless I start playing the lottery, which I don't intend to do. Let's say I won the Publisher's Clearinghouse sweepstakes. That one I have sent a couple of entries in, or HGTV Dream Home or something like that. If I won some kind of sweepstakes, and got a large check, the grace of God would be the foundation of my life that matters. It should be. If I put my trust in money or popularity or fame or any of those things, it's going to be sand that washes away. And if my life completely falls apart and crumbles around me, and I lose everything I have, everything in this world that matters, still my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. Nothing changes for the person who is filled by the Holy Spirit. Nothing changes because the grace of God is the foundation for joy unspeakable. Joy unspeakable is rooted in the grace of God. What He did in forgiving our sins, in saving us from our sins. Second word is hope. Now that's not related. The words aren't related, but they are paired together very often in the scriptures. Romans 15:13 says, "Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace." Those are our two words today. May the God of hope fill you with joy and peace as you believe, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Hope, in essence, is a tenth fruit of the Spirit. It's something that the Holy Spirit produces. It's the God of hope who produces joy and peace in us. So you see that there's a relationship here between joy and all these. So what is this hope? When we talk about hope, we're usually thinking of some kind of like wishing upon a star kind of a thing. Twinkle, twinkle, little star. And we have a pipe dream. I hope it happens, but I doubt it really will. I wish upon a star, but I really don't expect those wishes to come true. That's not what biblical hope is. Biblical hope, in a sense, is time travel. What you do is you take the promises that God has made you for the future, and you draw those promises to today, and you live on the basis of the reality of them today. So let's say that my life is completely falling apart today. So hope means that I look to the future and I say, I have an eternal home in heaven. And no matter what is going on in my life today, my eternity, my destiny is settled. And I am eternally loved. I am adopted into God's family, and everything is great. There are two scriptures, one in 2 Corinthians 4 and one in Romans 8, verse 18, that I just find absolutely Paul. Once again, this is one of those crazy verses of Paul. But in 2 Corinthians 4, now remember in 2 Corinthians 11, he details his sufferings. And I guarantee you, there's a lot of people in this room who are going through some suffering. A lot of families in this church have been through some extreme suffering. Nobody's been through anything like Paul described in 2 Corinthians 11. You're a long way away. Anybody been beaten 5 times with the 40 lashes minus 1? I think Paul... Anybody been thrown in prison for year after year because you preached the gospel? Paul's sufferings are extreme. Shipwreck, bitten by a snake. You know, Paul's sufferings are way up there. And he called his sufferings light and momentary. Compared. Now that's the key word. He's not saying that his sufferings don't matter. The Bible never says that your sufferings don't matter. They do. But he says our sufferings are light and momentary compared to the eternal weight of glory that will be revealed in you. See, you got to time travel. If I walk around with my head towards the ground, thinking about all the terrible things that are going on in the world or in life, perhaps in my family, what if I just think about all the terrible things in this world, Oh my goodness. But if I remember the eternal weight of glory that is the believer's hope, and I time travel and I bring that back and I live today on the basis of what will be, I'm going to steal something that's in next week's message. When I was a young pastor, I think it's in next week's message. When I was a young pastor, my first job, I moved in 1982, moved to Tequesta, and they were in the middle of building a beautiful building, cash as they went. $1 million building, they never had debt on the building. One of the most beautiful, most amazing things I ever saw. And when I got there, that place was a wreck. Florida gets a lot of rain. I think I've described this to you before. They had these big giant beams wrapped in this black plastic that would fall off, and it was dirty. And they made the mistake of building, somebody thought it would be good to build like a piano pit and a pit for the organ, and so that they wouldn't be seen. And they eventually had to build those up because it was a terrible idea. But anyway, in the front of the church, there were these pits, and water would get in them, and it would, you know, get gross. And this place was horrible and ugly. And I never once saw any person walk through that building and say, this place is a pigsty. What do you think people said? They walked through that building with the eyes of hope. This place is going to be gorgeous when it's finished. They extended hope and grace to a building, and they looked at that building and they said, wow, when this is done, it's going to be something. Wouldn't it be great if we extended that to one another? Look at those people out there. When God is finished with you guys, you're going to be great. Nobody, except me, you know, I'd go in like, man, that's nasty in there. Look at that stuff swimming around in there. But nobody went around nitpicking all the dirt and crud. Can a pastor say crud? Is that okay? Okay. Nobody went around nitpicking all the junk in that building. They just said, wow, it's going to be great. See, that's hope. It's going to be great, folks. And what we have to do is walk around daily. Romans 8:18 says that our current sufferings are nothing compared to the glory that will be revealed in us. You know what your future is? See, I said something false earlier. I said, I don't know what our future is. I do know my future. I don't know short term, but my future is glory. This body that you look at is going to be perfect. Can I get just one little amen? Okay, thank you. I'm going to have like the world's, no, not the world's most perfect, because you will too. We'll be perfect. We have perfection awaiting us. And what we're supposed to do daily is walk in the light of the perfection that we will have in Christ. Time travel. We travel out to the future, grasp hold of the blessings we will have, bring them back to today, and say, okay. So essentially, our joy is rooted in grace and hope. We remember what God has done for us. My sins have been washed away. My past is gone. My faults are under the blood of Christ, and my future is secure. And so in this difficult present, and I look out here and I see some people with a difficult present. In this difficult present, I can have, you can have unspeakable joy, not because everything is so wonderful. If you're looking for joy based on everything's wonderful, man, you got a tough row to hoe. But you can have unspeakable joy because The grace of God has washed clean your past, and the hope in God has given you blessings you can't even imagine in the future. And so today, man, you just hope. You just hope in Christ. And you have joy. You have joy in Jesus Christ. And that gives us a peace that passes understanding. Joy unspeakable and a peace that passes understanding. Now, there's two kinds of peace. One kind comes when you're sitting at the beach with lemonade. It's because we're Baptists. You know, we just do lemonade, guys, right? Yeah. I know, but just go with me, because just humor me, okay? You don't have a care in the world. You're just sitting there, and it's calm and peaceful. It's that peace when you're in the backyard over a campfire, which is illegal unless you're in the country, but unless you have maybe a fire pit, and somebody breaks out the graham crackers and the chocolate bars and the marshmallows, and you have one, and then you say, yeah, I'll have some more. And you're just like, yeah. See, that's the kind of peace anybody can have. It's a worldly peace. It doesn't mean it's evil. It just means it's a peace given by circumstances. I think that's why we love Andy Griffith so much. Wouldn't you just love to sit out on the porch with Andy strumming the guitar and let's go down and get us some soda pop at the drugstore. Yeah, let's do that and talk about that for 20 minutes before you finally do it. I mean, come on, that's peaceful. But unfortunately, that is not the world we live in. We don't actually live in that world either. We live in, you know, Sioux City's not exactly. I think that's Beijing or something. But we live in a helter-skelter world that zooms by us at speeds like we can't imagine. And the storms of life rage around us. And we can't simply sit on the beach. You know, one of the things I noticed, I don't know if you've picked up on the fact that some of the pictures there's been some irony in the pictures that I've used. Joy unspeakable and peace were pictures of storms. Because when I Googled joy and peace, all the pictures were like people sitting on the beach or standing at mountains and, you know, waving their arms and stuff like that. Look, folks, anybody can have that. Can you have? My dad was like king of the smart alecks. And there was a hurricane years ago. I know my stories are all old. I've told this one 70. Sorry, Jenny, just take a nap real quick. But this was back in, I think, 1980. I was in seminary. And there was a hurricane going through Tequesta, which is where my parents lived. And so I thought, well, I better call and see how they're doing. And I called my dad answered the phone. I said, how are you doing, Dad? He said, what on earth are you talking about? I said, well, the news says there's a hurricane. He says, I've never seen a bluer sky, and there's absolutely no wind right now, and it is as calm and beautiful as it could be. He says, I have no idea what you're talking about. Can you figure it out? They were in the eye of the storm. They were right smack dab in the eye of the hurricane, and of course, smart aleck Lou wouldn't, you know, that's who he was. But pretty soon, they got out of the eye. Things got real again. That's what we've got to find, folks. We can't live in Mayberry. We don't live in... Mayberry's gone. Never was there. But we don't live in Mayberry. There are storms all around us. And if you're looking for a peace based on sitting on the beach, you better win the lottery or HGTV Dream Home or, you know, Publishers Clearing House or something. Because if you're looking for peace that comes from sitting on the beach with a lemonade, that doesn't happen very often. You need the eye of the storm kind of peace. You need something different. You need, I just made up a new term, Christ active peace. A peace that passes understanding, a peace that comes from God's work in us. This is the biblical term shalom. Shalom, peace, it's the Hebrew phrase. And what it really means is an inner peace, a sense of well-being and wholeness rooted in a proper relationship with God. When we walk in obedience to God, we experience His blessing and His favor, and it gives us an inner sense of well-being. When you're right with God, you have this inner sense of well-being that floods your soul, and it changes the way you look. I know, again, I've told this story. I was so in Cedar Rapids. Everything was falling apart at the church. It was just so bad. And I went out on a walk one day. I was a lot younger back then, which makes sense. It was 30 years ago. We were all a lot younger 30 years ago. I don't know if you know that or not. But I went out on a walk. Later, I thought, man, I walked a long distance. I got my car, and it was 7 miles. And I just took a Bible, and I read my Bible, and I prayed the whole way. And when I got back, I had aligned my heart with God. Not a single circumstance in that church had changed. Not a single problem in that church had gone away. But I had shalom. My heart had changed. Because all of a sudden I had peace, a peace that passes understanding. Romans 15:33 says, "May the God of peace be with you all." Romans 16:20 is one of Paul's most delightful non sequiturs. I love this. He says, "The God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet." This is no wimpy God who makes peace by Neville Chamberlain kind of, giving in. This is a God who makes peace by defeating all of his enemies. He defeated death and sin and hell and Satan. And he promises believers in Philippians 4:9 that this God of peace will be with you. The God of peace will be with you. So you can defeat those. The God of peace, Hebrews 13:20-21, raised Jesus from the dead and will provide everything good to do his will. And this peace that comes from God comes to us in Christ Jesus and guards our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. This peace rules our hearts and minds and through Christ enables us. Now, here's the key. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 3, it's talking about a worthy walk in Christ. It tells us that we should be making every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. You see, God doesn't tell us to create peace, to make peace. He says to keep the peace. He makes the peace. When I kneel at the cross, and you kneel at the cross, and you kneel at the cross, we have peace. We have peace with God, and we have peace with one another. And as long as we don't walk in the flesh, when we walk in the flesh, we break the peace that God has given us peace. The church has peace. The church has unity. We break that unity when we walk in the flesh. We're in Christ, and He's given us new life and forgiveness and eternal place in heaven. We have peace in Christ as long as we don't break that peace by walking in the flesh. So here's what it's all about, folks. The fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit. We love. Because Christ loved us. Jesus loved me, this I know. And so because Jesus loved me, I can love others. We have joy because the grace of God settled our past sins and gives us an eternal hope of glory that we can reach out for and pull back into today's heartaches. We have peace with God through Jesus Christ. And that peace is a perfect peace that enables us to walk in peace with one another. The Spirit gives us hope in this time. The fruit of the Spirit is love. God is love, and in Christ I am loved eternally and infinitely. And that love is just as true whether things go well or things go badly. The fruit of the Spirit is joy. And whether you feel like rejoicing right now or not, we have real joy today because Jesus has paid our debts in full. My sins have been plunged beneath the flood, and I've lost all my guilty stains. I have the joy of grace. I have the joy of hope. And because of that, whatever suffering and pain and whatever troubles we may go through will be as nothing in eternity. One glimpse of his dear face, all sorrow will erase. The fruit of the Spirit is peace. We have peace today because the God of peace has conquered everything that troubles us, that gives us worry or stress or fear. And we can trust his glorious purposes in us. So whatever comes, we have love, we have joy, we have peace. Whatever comes in our lives today, we have joy unspeakable and peace unreasonable. Makes no sense, but we have it in Christ. And I hope you know these things. It's all about looking to Jesus and looking away from your problems, not looking down, but looking up, walking in him and in the joy and peace that he gives. The world's not going to give it to you. The world can give you a thrill. The world can give you chemicals that will make you stop thinking about problems or forget them for a time. The world has some fun. There's good things in this world. But only Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, can give you joy unspeakable and a peace that passes understanding, that just is unreasonable by human standards. Father, I pray that every person in this room would know this joy, unspeakable joy, a peace that passes understanding. Father, if there's someone here who is without Christ, religious perhaps, but has never put trust in Christ, move in that heart today to personally trust Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. But Father, every one of us, help us to respond to you and to remember what you have done for us in the past and what you will do in the future to give us joy and peace. In Jesus' name, amen.